Ever since I began taking a closer look at TF2, I've uncovered countless issues from the game's stairs, to its doors, and even its walls. But there's one thing in particular that I've been meaning to talk about for quite a while: the lighting. On seemingly every map, there's at least one instance where the lighting is whack, and while many have simple solutions, others present a greater issue at hand. But before I dive into examples, I want to go over how TF2 maps are lit to begin with. This video is sponsored by Manco.store, a TF2 marketplace where you can buy and sell TF2 items for real money. I've personally used them many times in the past and can vouch for their great prices and low fees. You can check them out through the link in the description. When a Valve map file, or VMF, gets turned into a playable map, or BSP, it passes through three compilers called VBSP, VViz, and VRad. For the sake of this video, we can ignore the first two because they don't affect the lighting. Instead, we'll be focusing on VRad, or Valve Radiosity, which is the tool used to embed light in source maps. All of your favorite Source 1 games, such as Half-Life 2, Portal, and Counter-Strike Global Offensive, utilize radiosity. But what does that mean? For you science nerds out there, here's the equation. But all I know is how it plays out when compiling a map, so let's focus on that. Here in Hammer, I've created a simple scene with a white light and some primitives surrounded by various colors. After compiling the map through VRad and viewing it in-game, we see that despite the only light source being this white light from above, all of the primitives' faces are illuminated and indirectly influenced by their surroundings. This alone might seem underwhelming, but radiosity was once the pinnacle of global illumination due to hardware constraints. Before, there was just direct illumination, represented through childhood classics like Sly Cooper, Crash Bandicoot, and Spy vs. Spy. Now, despite radiosity adding indirect light to the equation, it has its shortcomings. It can't produce specular reflections or highlights, pass through transparent surfaces, light dynamic objects, or produce dynamic lighting. But I just showed examples of all of these, so what's going on? Just because radiosity doesn't do these things doesn't mean Valve hasn't implemented other solutions to accommodate them. And as much as I'd love to go over each one, it's a lot to digest, so for this video, I'm gonna focus on how radiosity affects the size, look, and feel of TF2 maps, highlight problems it creates, and offer solutions. Radiosity treats each surface receiving light as a secondary emitter, meaning light gets shot back out uniformly in all directions instead of the most physically accurate one. The only property that controls how much light gets emitted is the color. A good way to see how this affects the overall look of an environment is with Toy Story. At the time, Pixar's rendermen didn't support path tracing or PBR materials, so its environments were lit in such a way that everything looked like it was made of the same thing, plastic. But for Toy Story, that was largely okay because the toys themselves are made of plastic. And that's where I think radiosity works surprisingly well for TF2. Even though different materials interact with light roughly the same way, that's actually okay because TF2's illustrative art style doesn't call for those materials to look that different. In fact, making these materials interact with light more realistically can jeopardize the look of the game. That's why when I was porting TF2 maps to Source 2, I was extra careful not to go overboard with the metalness and normal maps. They just don't make that much sense in a painterly environment. But just like how Toy Story evolved over the years adopting better lighting methods, so can TF2. And if you're curious how, please take a look at my past two videos where I do just that in the Source 2 engine. But to demonstrate how here in Source 1, consider the following example with these cubes. In TF2, each of their shadows shares the same softness, whereas in Blender, using a path tracer, we see that the shadows start soft and get sharper as the cube approaches the ground. But this difference isn't just because of radiosity. It also has to do with the way the light is stored in the map. If you hop into any TF2 map, open the console, and type Matte Texture List 1, you get a list of every rendered texture. But by expanding the menu and enabling Render Targets and Special Textures, we see all of the light maps which store the map's lighting. You can also run the command mat show lightmap page followed by the lightmap number to pin the corresponding lightmap in the corner of your screen to see which parts of it are actively rendered. In Dust Bowl, there are 8, but this number can vary depending on the size of the map. For example, Turbine only has 3, while Patagonia has 22. But size isn't everything. Theoretically, you can have a smaller map with more light maps. But before I get to that, we first need to understand what a light map is. The Valve Wiki defines it as a generated texture applied to a brush face to simulate lighting. During VRAD, all of the static lighting produced by light entities gets calculated and stored in light maps, which are just image textures. If you zoom in, you see that only the lighting information is stored. In-game, when you run the command matfulbright1, you view the world without light maps. And through the command matfulbright2, light maps are all you see. Well, mostly. For some reason, blend materials still show alongside overlays, entities, and props, which don't actually use light maps. But you get the idea. Every piece of world geometry gets put into a light map. But as is the case with many things in mapmaking, leaving everything to its default and letting the compiler run can produce negative results. That's why Valve gave us the ability to control how much space world geometry can take up in light maps through these things called luxels, so that we can increase and decrease the resolution in certain areas to improve and optimize our maps. So what is a luxel? It means light map pixel, which is the smallest unit of light data stored for world geometry in a light map. By default, one luxel is 16 hammer units across, or about half as wide as a dispenser. And returning to this ball and cube, this is how their shadows look at this resolution. Running the command matluxels1 shows us the boundary of the luxels stored in the light maps. And as you can see, there's not a lot of light information to be stored around these two objects at this resolution, resulting in poor shadow quality. Doubling the resolution to 8 hammer units offers a massive improvement because there are now 4 luxels for every spot where there was just 1. And maximizing the resolution to 2 gives the highest possible luxel density and therefore the most accurate lighting. Comparing it to TF2's default of 16, you might be scratching your head wondering why this is the default. Why not set everything to the highest possible resolution? There are two answers, compile time and file size. Take Dust Bowl. It's only about 20 megabytes and takes me 3.5 minutes to fully compile. If I were to set the resolution of everything to 2, I'd be increasing the number of luxels and the compile time by a factor of 64. Meaning it'd take me over 3.5 hours to compile and over 1.2 gigabytes of space. Given that there are over 200 maps in TF2, that equate to a lot of compiling and a lot of space, which is totally unnecessary because there's no need to have such a high resolution in places where it's not needed. A good analogy is JPEGs. They exist to provide a good enough result with smaller file sizes and faster write times, and do so by eliminating less important data using the discrete cosine transform. Unfortunately, there's no equivalent in source, so we have to do the heavy lifting. But by selectively deciding where to increase or decrease the luxel scale, we can reduce the file size and compile time without jeopardizing a map's visuals. In fact, the map should actually look better because you'd be increasing the resolution where it's most warranted. A good example is this spot on Upward. Despite the sun hitting these wooden fences at a sharp 55 degree angle, they produce no perceivable shadows on the floor because its luxel scale is set to 16. Increasing the resolution to 4 makes the shadows visible, but because of how detailed the fence is, raising it to 2 is best. And this is okay, because many other areas can have the resolution decrease to compensate for the greater compile time and file size. The most common areas where this is done are the tops of roofs and sides of buildings because they're often fully illuminated by the sun or shielded from it. And having a higher resolution for a constant value doesn't improve anything. After learning about light maps, I grew curious about how optimized they are throughout TF2. So a friend and I reviewed every attack, defense, and payload map, scoring them from 0 to 2, where 0 represents no light map optimization, 1 represents some, and 2 represents most or all. 13 maps received a score of 0 and 1, and 14 maps receive 2, equating to an average score of 1, meaning your average map has at least some optimization, but this is far from the ideal value of 2. I was surprised to see community favorites like Swiftwater and Upward with no optimization, and bad maps like Venice and Cashworks with most or full optimization. And I'm curious to know how the average would change if I included every TF2 map. But there's no way I'm gonna look at a bunch of blue boxes on over 200 maps. Even I have my limits. For the latter half of this video, I've been talking about Luxels, what they are, how to see them, and how to work with them. But there's something about them I haven't touched on that only became relevant a few months ago. In the Half-Life 2 20th anniversary update, TF2 received 2 major updates to how the world is rendered: bicubic light maps and radial fog. You see, while Luxels are the smallest unit in a light map, they're not smaller than the pixels on your screen, so the engine needs to interpolate between them to make the lighting appear smooth. Until recently, TF2 used bilinear interpolation, which samples 4 Luxels in a 2x2 space. Bicubic interpolation, on the other hand, samples 16 in a 4x4 space. This extra information should yield better results, or smoother shadows, but after you hear about this, you'll never see TF2 maps the same way. In edge cases where 2 or more adjacent sets of Luxels are split into their own UV islands in the light map texture, bicubic interpolation produces seams. And this doesn't just happen some of the time, it happens every time and everywhere, and only under bicubic interpolation. So in the off chance that you've walked through a map these past several months and wondered why there was suddenly a line, now you know. I wish I could solve this, but I'm not a mathematician, so we can only hope that Valve properly diagnoses and remedies this issue, because it happens everywhere on every map, and I can't unsee it. As for solvable issues, light bleeding is something that can be corrected. Normally, when you compile a map, the parts of world geometry that touch each other are erased or culled. And while it's a critical part of map optimization, it also prevents bilinear and bicubic interpolation algorithms from sampling light through geometry. Take this room I've constructed in Hammer with 2 lights separated by a wall. When the wall is set to world geometry, the faces that touch the floor, back wall, and ceiling are erased, preventing any interpolation through it. But if I turn it into a funk detail, or any other brush entity, those faces are not erased, which results in a type of bleeding where the light gets interpolated across the brush face through the wall. A great example of this that I covered in one of my shorts is this area on Frontier, where the sunlight bleeds through the roof and wall. This might lead you to believe that using world geometry will always give you the best lighting, but thanks to bicubic interpolation, that assumption is wrong. Remember, adjacent sets of Luxels produce seams under bicubic interpolation, and the culling of the parts of the cube and floor touching each other split the floor into multiple faces that bicubic interpolation struggles with. By turning the cube into a funk detail, I retain each face, which removes the seam, but at the cost of a little bit of some ambient occlusion type effect. So unless you decrease the Luxel scale to localize the error, you have no other remedies. And with that frustration, I'm ending this video. It blows my mind how something as simple as shadows can run this deep. I had expected to make one video covering the entirety of TF2's lighting, but after going down this radiosity rabbit hole, that ceased to be an option. But because there's a lot more to cover, I do intend to talk more about TF2's lighting in the future. Thank you for watching. This is LED, switching off.